Ready? Good evening. I'd like to call the March meeting of the Village of Oak Brook Zoning Board of Appeals to order. Gail, will you call the roll, please?
Yes. Bulin?
Here.
Capetta?
Here.
Nimri?
Here.
Rush?
Here.
Young?
Here.
Zimmer?
Here.
Davis?
Here, and we have a full complement and a quorum, and we will proceed with the items on the agenda. There are four items on the agenda for this evening. Before we get to that, we have two sets of minutes that need approval. The minutes of our November 3, 2009 regular meeting, and then the minutes of the November 30 joint special meeting that we had with the Plan Commission. Are there any changes or corrections to either set of minutes? If not, could I have a motion to waive the reading of the minutes and approve them as written?
So moved.
Second.
All right, we'll do one set at a time. First, the minutes of November 3. It's been moved and seconded that those minutes be approved. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Now, the same motion has been made for the November 30, 2009 minutes. Is there a motion to approve those minutes?
So moved.
Second, moved and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay. The minutes will have been approved as written.
Chairman Davis, I'd like to make a motion regarding our agenda for this evening.
You may.
Item 5A on the agenda, new business, the Fullersburg Historic Foundation. I'd like to make a motion that we continue that to the next meeting.
Item 4B.
I have it as 5A.
That's interesting. It's 4B in my agenda, so. Sorry, I'm getting an updated agenda here.
For a couple of reasons. There's been a number of people in my community, which backs up to the York Tavern, that have some concerns that I'd like to be able to address with the community before we have any discussion at the meeting. And then second, the package we received a little bit late because Gail was sick. So I didn't get it till Saturday evening. So I'd like a little bit additional time to review the information. And I know this is something that's been going on for quite some time at the Plan Commission. So I'd like to make sure that we have adequate time to review the information prior to having the hearing. So I'd like to make that motion that we continue it to the next meeting.
All right. Is there a second to the motion?
Second.
Any comments or discussion from the board members? Okay, Gail, can we have a voice vote on this? Any comments from the public? If this is a motion to continue the matter, if it is continued, if the board agrees, votes to continue it, it will be continued to.
This was noticed in the paper, though.
Pardon?
If it was noticed in the paper for this date.
No, I don't think so.
Just
yes, if the matter is continued, it would be continued to our next regular meeting. And what is the date for our next regular meeting?
Which would be April 6th.
It would be April 6th at the same at 7:30 at this same location. Do you want to call a roll and for the motion to continue the matter?
Bulin?
Yes.
Capetta?
Yes.
Nimri?
Yes.
Rush?
Yes.
Young?
Yes.
Zimmer?
Yes.
Davis?
Yes. And the purpose of the motion is to make sure we have a full-blown hearing and hear everybody's views and that we're fully prepared to adequately discuss all the issues and we'll be better informed by continuing the matter. And it will be continued to April 6th. And thank you for coming. And I assume anyone who's here who plans to speak either in favor of or in opposition of the proposal will be at our April 6th meeting and we'll listen to you at that time. Thank you. The next item on our agenda is item 4A, and that's the matter of the appeal by Mr. Zuby, 3719 Madison Street. It's an appeal from a decision of the Village of Oak Brook Code Enforcement Officer regarding the fence height of a fence located at the property, at the subject property. And we have closed the evidence on this hearing, and according to my recollection, all that remains would be closing comments. Is that your understanding, Mr. Daniel?
That's correct, Mr. Chairman.
All right. Mr. Killeen, is that your understanding also? Okay. Mr. Daniel, you are the appellant. You may proceed.
Mr. Chairman, at this point in time, first of all, I'll introduce myself. I'm Mark Daniel with Daniel Law Office, PC, 136 West Valette Street, Suite 3, Elmhurst, Illinois, 60126. At this point in time, I do want to thank everybody. We opened this hearing in a way where we relied a lot on staff. And Mr. Killeen provided quite a bit of testimony. I believe that at this point in time, I would invite the ZBA to allow Mr. Killeen perhaps to make his statement in light of the evidence. Perhaps he's learned a few things. One of the important circumstances that we started with was that the fence was legal in as much as the height is concerned. And we're dealing with the determination of grade at this point in time. But I would allow Mr. Killeen, or recommend the ZBA allowing Mr. Killeen to make any statements. If you have questions of Mr. Killeen, and then I'd be happy to follow up. Once again, we make sure the issues are still clear. We can keep streamlined. I think 5 to 10 minutes is all that I would have after that.
All right, and in your closing argument, make sure you review what you believe the issues are so that we can make that determination, and in all likelihood, we'll make that determination this evening.
Perfect.
Mr. Killeen.
Again, I will just take a few minutes. This has been an issue that is somewhat unique in Oak Brook. Oak Brook is a community that's roughly 50 years old. Our regulations that affect fences being 42 inches high, 50% open, as measured from natural grade, have existed back to 1976. Prior to 1976, I can't tell you what the regulations were. The ordinance was somewhat silent to it, so I can't tell you what the regulations were before that. Since I've been here in the past 11 years, the situation that's occurred with Mr. Zuby is unique. We have a situation where there has been fill added to the property in conformance with a grading plan. But that filling occurred really after the initial construction of the fence was started. And usually things occur in a different sequence than that. Our ordinance is very clear in that the village engineer has the authority to establish elevations based on previous grades and new grades for single family homes. In my reading of the code, I do not know if that provision extends to accessory structures like fences, accessory garages, and so forth. So in my opinion, we have a contradiction in our code. And I laid that out in my initial information to you. I've expressed that to Mr. Zuby from the beginning that there was a conflict. And what I'd ask is, no matter what this body does relative to this appeal, I think one of the directives of staff is that this matter, not the Zuby matter, but the language that exists within our zoning ordinance relative to how structures are to be measured, I think we need to clean that language up to end any ambiguity, any contradiction as such, because I do not want to have to go through this situation with another property in the future. We have a new village engineer. Our community development department and engineering have worked out the details in terms of coordinating so that this situation cannot repeat itself. So that's basically what I have.
What basically is it that, remind us again what the contradiction is?
Well, okay, in the zoning ordinance, in the definition sections, there's a definition for natural ground level. And I will read that it says, the existing elevation prior to any movement of organic or non-organic matter, which would require the issuance of a permit under the ordinances of the village, or the proposed elevation is depicted on a subdivision grading plan approved by the village or is otherwise reasonably determined by the village engineer. So there it gives the latitude of the village engineer to establish these grades. We now go to the structure height. In the first part of the definition under section 13.3.8 of the zoning code, it says structure height is stated that no structure shall be erected, converted, expanded, reconstructed, or structurally altered to exceed the height limit measured above the natural grade level as determined by the village engineer for the district in which the structure is located. And it further goes on down in later in that section. It says structure height may be measured from a base elevation other than natural ground level only with the express approval of the village. When we went through the code, we found references to the community development director specifically. We found references to the village engineer specifically. And when it mentions the village, the interpretation has been made, at least in the past, that refers to some higher body, which is the village board. And that's where I think the contradiction lies.
So, I mean, one could read approval of the village might be your approval, or it could be the village engineer's approval.
Or some other body. It could be a zoning board, a plan commission, some other entity. And that's not very clear.
All right.
So really, that's the basis of the issue.
Mr. Daniel?
Thank you. Again, the ZBA members have put a lot of time into this. We've been here for, I believe, three nights. We attempted to close this out last meeting, and the Zubies and I certainly appreciate your patience here. We've been put in the position of having to create what's known as a legal record. There were some details that are there factually that we had to get into, but this is indeed a really simple matter. The question is whether, under the circumstances, the Zoning Board of Appeals is going to affirm the decision or reverse the decision of January 23rd, as stated in Mr. Kleen's letter, which is Exhibit A. Obviously, there are impacts of affirming the decision. If that's the case, the Zubies have to look at their remedies and either go to the Village Board for review or go into the Circuit Court. And unfortunately, the Zubies have been dealing with litigation with their neighbors, and that litigation has driven a lot of the decision-making here because of vested rights and arguments that are prevailing in the Circuit Court. Unfortunately, it's a venue that none of us can necessarily control. So for that, I apologize, but those are the cards that we all are dealt with this evening. Affirming the decision may create a further problem. Reversing it, though, doesn't necessarily cause any harm. There are two grounds on which the decision can be reversed. First, you could find that the Zubies and Palos Bank are correct, and that the letter of January 23rd should not have issued. Okay, second of all, even if you believe the January 23rd letter is correct, the ZBA could find that under the circumstances, this matter has involved a permit that was almost 2 years old. The fence construction was 99% complete, if not complete, depending on how you look at the project and how it progressed. There was some fill that was accomplished. There was final landscaping that was accomplished. That was done later, as you saw, the testimony on site showed that it was done after the letter issued, and it was properly done because there was a grading plan that came about that was approved by engineering. If you take that grading plan and the structure of the fence, take the grading plan as approved and the structure of the fence, you have compliance with the ordinance. I think Mr. Kleen may have indicated to you that you don't have an issue as to the height above the ground level that is out there now. The question really is, what is that ground level? It is a ground level that exists currently, but do you have to have a village board vote on it? Under Mr. Colleen's interpretation, you would have someone file an application for a determination of natural grade. After that natural grade has been addressed through engineering, after plans have been submitted, and as engineering is progressing. And mind you, during this process, it was a special situation, not just because of the nature of the determination of natural grade without a plat of subdivision or a PUD or a special use of some kind. It was simply a single-family permit for construction, and there was a demolition involved. The demolition issues, the planning for the property, those issues, when they arise, tend to set off the application for accessory structures and for a final grading plan. Okay, there was an existing house up front that had to come down. In addition to that, you had the issues with the neighbors to the north. Okay, not only was there litigation, as I mentioned previously, but there were also changed circumstances. One of the reasons that we walked you around the north property line of the Zuby property was to show you what occurred in the way of change as the project on the Zuby property progressed. Tree removal, grading in an easement area that is a new easement area, the installation of a drainage system. Okay, regardless of what occurred, we all know that there's a storm sewer in that easement area. And the construction of that storm sewer was considered sincerely by the engineering staff. No fewer than two people were directing, from engineering, were directing the Zubies to plan and design their front yard area in a way that would coexist with the sewer system to the north. And a lot of that occurred after the permit for the fence was issued. Okay, you'll recall, I think it is in Exhibit W, that there's shown a level elevation that's uniform across the base of the fence. The intent was to have a fence of uniform elevation. Okay. The grading around the fence was a question that was under review by the engineering department. And as Mr. Killeen mentioned, there's a definition in section, I think it's 13-2-2. He read that accurately. Natural ground level can be reasonably determined by the village engineer. According to the plan that was approved by engineering, we believe that it was reasonably determined by the village engineer. And when you take that natural ground level under the definition in 13-2-2, and you count up by number of inches, you have a compliant fence. Okay, you may have some architectural changes to the caps, but the fence under the code as measured is compliant. And that is very important in this instance. Again, section 13-3-8 in subsection A, Mr. Killeen accurately read the first sentence. The measurement occurs above the natural ground level as determined by the village engineer. Again, we believe the village engineer made a determination. In subsection C, there's another reference to natural ground level. Now, this village board issue comes up in circumstances where there's a disagreement. Engineering says, wait a second, developer or home builder, a property owner that wants to build a fence or what have you, I have a problem here, because as the village engineer, I view the natural ground level as one elevation, and your plans show it as another. In this instance, there was agreement. And that's how the development progressed. So there wouldn't be a need to go to the village board. If you were to interpret the ordinances in a way that requires village board approval, in all instances, to protect people from this ambiguity, certainly this has been an inconvenience to the Zubies and to the village, but if you do interpret the code in a way as to affirm Mr. Killeen's decision, you're going to set up a separate application process where natural grade or natural ground level has to be determined in almost every instance by the village board, and that's not what the engineer's here for. You've got a great staff. The assistant engineer was terrific on this project, communicative. He took input from the owners to the north. He referred that input. He reflected that input in the plan requests, the modification requests, where you do see berms on the property running from west to east along the north lot line, parallel to that lot line. Those are the results of communications with the neighbor. It progressed as it should. Staff was very responsive. Staff compelled reaction to concerns from the neighbors to the north. The village did the right thing. The engineer issued a grading plan, approved the grading, And we're at a point where we actually do have compliant grading, development pursuant to that grading plan, a fence above that natural ground level shown in the grading plan, and a compliant fence. It meets the height requirements. So under the circumstances, I would ask that you reverse the decision shown in that January 23rd letter. I do not believe it sets precedent that creates a problem for the village. All right, I believe that the Zubies are correct in their assertion that the January 23rd letter issued an error. I don't want to get into a discussion over authority into the code and things like that. Those are legal issues. But on the substance, the principal argument is that the Zubies are correct, that engineering did what it was supposed to do in this instance. All right, and on the other issue, let's just set the substance aside from a legal perspective and from a factual perspective. This issue arose nearly 2 years after the issuance of the permit. Okay, and to have well over $100,000 in planning and construction progress in reliance upon a permit and then have that letter issue, there's certainly shock and surprise on the part of the permittee. It may be that some of you believe that, well, the village ought to do more somehow for the owners to the north. Mr. Beard has been here. He's spoken up at the podium. He spoke up at the property when we met out there. He provided some substantive input at the property on what occurred. And maybe you feel torn between the two. You can justify a reversal of the appeal on the basis that this has gone on. The construction went on and progressed in reliance on that permit. And in fairness, at this point in time, in light of what you've heard, we should allow the fence to remain, regardless of who's right. We don't have to say Mr. Beard is wrong. We don't have to say the Zubies are correct. Under the circumstances, usually you won't, on such a technical issue, you won't hear from a planner like Joe Abel. The only reason we brought him in was to show you that from a planning perspective, in addition to your own observations, but to have a planner come out and say what I believe no one really disagrees with. The fence fits, given the development on the property, the setback of the house, the design of the house and the carriage house. It doesn't cause a problem or a rupture in planning for the area. Sure, there may be differences in how things could have been handled. Someone might have proposed a post and rail fence and the Zubies didn't. That's one thing that you heard from Mr. Beard. That's a matter of taste. That's not a matter of planning. So Mr. Abel gave you the basis, the foundation, from a planning perspective, under your ordinances, under your comprehensive plan, to analyze the issue and say, regardless of who we find is right here, there's been reliance, detrimentally by the Zubies, to a significant expense. We went out to the property. We saw the elevation underneath the fence. We have no one before us saying that that fence height is illegal. Nobody is saying that the height of the fence is illegal. The question is one of that natural ground level and how it was determined given the progression of development. I believe it was determined. The Zubies believe it was determined by the village engineer, and it was appropriately determined during that grading process. So I believe that they are correct, but if they're not, you can still reverse the decision of January 23rd based on fairness. I'd be happy to answer any questions that you may have. The Zubies appreciate your time and effort during this process. Mr. Killeen, staff has been very helpful. Gail especially, during the period where this was somewhat lingering before we went to hearing. Thank you again.
I have a question. When and how was the natural ground level determined by the village engineer?
The natural ground level with the engineer was under evaluation through plans submitted prior to the issuance of permit. There were plans shown that exhibit, I think it's W, showed the plans for the fence in light of the existing grades on the property. The utility sign-off was necessary in advance of the final decision by engineering, and the final decision did not come until after the fence was constructed.
Well, in what format was the approval by the village engineer? Are you saying the approval was implicit in the issuance of the permits?
The revised site grading plan was approved February 11th of 09, and that was after the issuance of a permit. And that was submitted as, so we're clear, Exhibit V is in Victor.
So you're saying it wasn't until 09 that the final grading permit was, or the final grading plan was approved, but whatever was approved at that time, the fence height is consistent with that. That's your argument?
Well, that's correct, but that same plan, Exhibit V, was under consideration by the village for months and prior to that.
When did it first go to the village? Is it V as in Victor?
Yes. I believe it was September or October of 2008, and I know Mr. Kleen may have had a record of that in his file. We didn't have too many contests over the facts here.
The preliminary grading plan was issued, or the drawing was dated November 19th of 2008. Which exhibit that was, I don't recall.
I would note that the electronic mail to Mr. Kleen that we had focused on a little bit prior to the issuance of permit did to an extent reflect the grade, because you had the above ground and below ground improvements shown in that plan. There were solid lines shown for the fence posts, the stone posts that you saw, and there were also dashed lines shown for the below ground improvements and footings. So grade was also reflected in that electronic mail to Mr. Kleen. I believe it was November 1st of 2007, Exhibit G.
Well, I'm looking at that right now. Run through that argument again. That email to Mr. Kleen was prior to the issuance of the fence permit, correct?
That's correct.
All right. And the significance of this is, again,
if you take a look at the attachments to that email,
yes,
you will see the proposed fence, and the above ground portions of the fence are shown as having a solid line, and the below ground portions of the fence as having a dashed line, so that we knew that there was going to be some material brought in.
Does this also depict that the...
I don't know how you draw that conclusion.
That the natural grade is the same as that of the guest house?
That's the other portion of the argument, yes.
That's the second drawing, right?
Yes.
Okay. Are there any other questions or...
Yeah, I have a question to the village engineer. In my packet dated 1/5/10, there's a picture number 5. It's an H11H. I'm wondering if that is the plan that engineering approved, because it obviously has dirt brought in to bring the fence into compliance. And the two pictures on that page both show that.
Joe, which one? Say it again. What's the...
It's 11H pictures. I guess it's 4 and 5.
And the question is?
If that is the plan that engineering approved.
The approved plan from engineering is dated, it's approved 3/10/09.
Yeah, but...
These are taken 9/4/08.
The picture that you're referring to, 11H.
Yeah.
That's pretty much conforms to the plan, which is approved on 3/10/09.
But the photos were taken on 9/4/08, correct?
Right. I'm looking at the topo that was approved 3/10/09, and it pretty much conforms to what you see on that picture.
I'm having trouble with figuring out how you determine that. Because you're not looking at the picture I'm looking at. Why don't you look at this?
This is the picture we're looking at.
Right.
So...
And this is the drawing I'm looking at.
Okay. So are you saying that the conformance?
Yeah.
There's a lot of difference.
Pretty much what it says there.
Just in timing.
Because it's obvious that the grazer changed it.
Yeah.
Okay.
But it was approved.
But the time period for the work in progress, I mean, there's been the construction period is a long duration, correct?
Your approval came after the grades were established or the new fill was brought in.
I never approved anything in this matter, actually. And the person who approved it was an engineer in training who was not the village engineer.
You know, I have trouble correlating this with that picture.
Well, it correctly depicts what...
This has the elevation lines on it, but the picture don't. Yeah,
right,
this does not show fill, and the picture does.
Right, which is why, you know, you hire engineers, but...
And that's my question. Is this what was you approved or the engineering approved to begin
with? That's what was approved by Phil Lauris of who now works for me, of the engineering department, on 3/10/2009.
Right, and that is the final approved grading plan?
Yes.
The same question could be about K as well.
What I'm getting at is I can't see how this picture you can correlate with what's on here.
It's a topographic depiction of it. It's
but it doesn't show anything about fill being brought in.
Doesn't make any difference when it was brought in. I'm just saying that the topographic depiction on the approved plan of 3/10/09 generally matches what is in that picture that you're referring to and what is out there now.
But what was the picture shows it being installed prior to your approval.
Prior to approval by someone in the engineering department.
Right. So it was already installed.
Yes.
By the time you approved it.
Yeah. By the time it was approved.
Without a permit. Without a permit. So it was done without a permit.
It was done without an approved grading.
Okay.
So it becomes which came first, the chicken or the egg?
Right, exactly.
But that's sort of one of the questions that I have. I mean, Mr. Klein, you know, try to address the issue kind of moving forward, you know, just assume, take this, you know, particular details out of the question for a minute. We had two parallel paths that were going on, one architectural being the actual fence, the other being the civil and the grading of the ground, and those were running parallel and basically without a tie to each other necessarily. And really moving forward, you know, in addition to clarifying the village and who that might be, I mean, it seems as though we would want to be able to tie, you know, both the sequencing and the granting of the approval and also the correlation between, you know, what is the approved grade so that we don't get into this kind of situation again.
I agree. There were two paths that were ongoing, the civil and the construction, the building permit, and, you know, maybe in the from the owner's perspective, I think all along they knew what they wanted on that property.
Mm-hmm.
But the individual, when you look at what, when the individual reviewed the fence permit, I think that person, that he's no longer with the village, but it's my impression from his comments is that he was unaware of the substantial amount of fill that would be added to the property.
Right.
And therefore, in the future, the issuance and the review and issuance of building permits must work hand in hand with the civil work and engineering work that goes on.
Right, because one got approved before the other, and I think those two need to coincide so that we don't get into the situation again.
Yeah, if I may, I've just been a village engineer since the 1st of August,
mm-hmm.
and since that time, we do not issue any permits for moving any earth until the final grades are determined. There is a modification that I'm recommending that be made to the village code to do away with natural grade and to substitute the terms ordained grade, because natural grade is an ambiguous term,
mm-hmm.
which really doesn't mean anything. Ordained grade is more accurate. Ordained grade is the approved grade, and it's much more accurate. The ordained grade is what is ordained by the village engineer in an approved set of grading plans, period. That will take care of, but in the language we're left with existing right now is natural grade, and natural grade I can only take as approved grade by the village engineer. I was not the village engineer when these drawings were approved, but one of my people was in that capacity, Phil Loris, so the only thing I can do is back up his approval and say that was ordained grade or natural grade.
So the grade that they're at is the approved grade?
Or approved, yes.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Mr. Daniel, you have anything further?
Nothing further. It's an important vote, obviously. Statute requires that four members of the Zoning Board of Appeals vote in favor of the appeal.
Well, we can handle it two ways. We can ask for a motion to reverse the decision and take a vote on that and see how that turns out. Do you have a preference as to how you'd like to proceed?
However you usually proceed, a vote to...
Well, there's no usual way of proceeding because this is the first matter we've had since I've been on the zoning board.
Perhaps a motion to accept the appeal and reverse the decision would be appropriate. It doesn't require a basis to be stated, meaning you don't have to say which prong of our closing argument the vote is proceeding under.
All right, and one of your prongs is based on, just to make sure I understand it right, is based on the fact that you believe the fence is compliant based on the ordained grade or the natural grade as approved by the village. Regardless of when it was approved, you believe the fence is compliant. And your other argument is, regardless of whether the fence is compliant, you believe that there was detrimental reliance on the permit, and to come back 2 years later in an what I'd consider quite an unfortunate situation would be unfair to the petitioner, and on that ground alone, that would be a basis for a reversal of the decision.
That's accurate.
And what do you mean by a motion to accept the appeal?
Well, to accept the propositions in the appeal that the decision should be reversed.
Okay. All right. Any other questions or discussion by members of the board? Anybody have any comments or thoughts that they'd like to share? No? None from the right? Any from the left? Well, do we have a motion? And a possible motion is to accept the appeal and reverse or overturn the decision of the code enforcement officer. So do we have a motion in that respect?
So moved.
All right, is there a second?
Second.
It's moved and seconded that we accept the appeal, the issues in the appeal, and that we reverse the decision of the staff.
So a yes vote is reversing the decision.
Yes.
And a no vote is keeping the decision.
Yes.
Okay.
You're correct. I shouldn't say yes.
I understand.
I really confuse things. Gail, do you want to call the roll, please?
Capetta?
Yes.
Bulin?
No.
Nimri?
No.
Rush?
No.
Young?
No.
Beamer?
Yes.
Davis?
Yes.
That motion failed.
That motion failed. Is there a motion to
affirm
or ratify the decision of the code enforcement officer?
I'll so move.
Is there a second to that motion?
Second.
Gail, will you call the roll?
Bulin?
Here, we're confirming.
No, this is affirming.
Affirming.
This will be affirming the decision of the staff.
Okay. Yes.
Capetta?
No.
Nimri?
Yes.
Rush?
Yes.
Young?
Yes.
Beamer?
No.
Davis?
No.
That motion carries.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Daniel. It's been a long, arduous process. We appreciate your input. Yeah, do we need to, should we put this stuff back in order?
Oh, yeah, I'll take it.
You're going to need a truck.
All right.
No, I'm going to hurt my back. I need to leave it all here.
The next item on the agenda is a petition by ITT Technical Institute. The subject property is at 800 Jory Boulevard, and it's for approval of a special use to permit a non-residential post-baccalaureate school. Have I said that properly?
Correct.
Okay, good. Would you introduce yourselves and if either of you are presenting testimony, I'll swear you in as a witness. That's our normal procedure.
Absolutely. My name is Zachary Fox. I am with Transwestern as an agent for the ownership of 800 Jory. The ownership is SBMS 2000 C3 Jory Plaza, LLC.
What's an interesting name? Does that, what all does that mean?
It's a fun name. LNR Partners is the manager. They would be the technical owner, but they've placed it under the fund. I'm not 100% sure of the financial reasoning for that, but they do operate a number of funds across the country, and this is the one that Jory Plaza falls
and
into.
And it's a corporate, a limited liability company?
Correct, yes.
Okay, good.
Good evening. My name is Larry Bruick. I'm the director of the current ITT Technical Institute in Burr Ridge, Illinois.
Okay, good evening. Why don't you both, I'll swear you both in because you may be giving in the nature of testimony. Would you raise your right hands? Do you swear or affirm the testimony you're about to give at this hearing will be the truth? Okay, you may proceed, Mr. Flax.
Ladies and gentlemen, as I said, my name is Zachary Fox for Transwestern as agent for ownership of 800 Jory. We are petitioning for a special use permit for ITT Technical Institute to operate a school in an ORA 1 zoned office building. Just to review, on February 15th, 2010, the Plan Commission voted 6-0 to recommend approval of a special use permit to allow ITT Technical Institute to operate a school in said ORA-1 zoned office building. They did approve this, they did recommend this on three conditions, the first being ITT Technical Institute shall occupy 21,107 square feet of space located at 800 Jory Boulevard in substantial conformance with plans that are submitted. You will find these plans on page E of the case file. This is the case. The plans have been accepted and agreed by both landlord and tenant and incorporated into the lease document, and we are moving ahead as would be with such. The second condition is that ITT Technical Institute will comply with all other rules and ordinances of the Village of Oak Brook. It is my understanding that this approval, this pending approval, does not grant building permits, does not grant sign permits. It is simply the permit to occupy the space. Any permits that are needed from here on out would be handled separately, and we do understand that, as well as ITT and everyone involved on their side. The third issue that was brought up was about security of the premises, and this was a larger issue. Mr. Colleen had talked about getting recommendations from the Oak Brook Police Department. We are heavily in favor of that. Security for the students, faculty, staff, visitors is number one on ITT Technical Institute's list. They definitely hold that very high. And just to run down kind of in the lease document what we have provided for safety issues that will be provided at the premises, 800 Jory. We'll be installing a state-of-the-art security system, motion detection, and alarm system. The provider would be ADT, pending approval and pricing and such, but we would be installing that and updating all fire detection and suppression systems, as well as emergency exits with bars and alarms to be completely unlocked from the inside, to be opened by anyone. New fire extinguishers and sprinkler heads where needed per code. Replacement of and updating of all fire extinguishers, locks, and whatnot on the building. All building doors will be locked except for the restrooms, and that's just a basic safety feature. We also are addressing the issue of lighting on the premises. We're installing 2x4 lighting, one unit for every 100 square feet, maintaining an average about 80-foot candles at a 3-foot level from the finished floor. Also, we're maintaining a 3 to 4 foot candle range for the pavement or the parking area, and a 1 foot candle range for the common walkways. These are all included in the lease document. The subject property itself, 800 Jory Boulevard, is a two-building complex. It's about 197,000 square feet. Currently stands at about 75% vacant. We have large vacancies. The building that ITT is looking to occupy is the 800 Jory building. It's about 129,000 square feet, currently standing at approximately 86% vacant. There is one tenant in there. It's Navisite. They occupy 17,000 square feet within the building. The other building, the 810 building, is not connected. It's a separate building within the complex. There is one tenant in there, XO Communications. They occupy about 32,000 square feet. That building does remain, though, just under 50% vacant at the moment. a little background from IIT as far as how they operate. They are they provide education services across the United States, 37 different states they are located in. They operate 125 different locations. It's a publicly traded company on the New York Stock Exchange, and they have currently around 70,000 students enrolled right now. The schools they offer are information technology, drafting and design, electronics technology, school of business, criminal justice, and health sciences. Of those, all would be offered at the Oak Brook location except for the health sciences. We don't foresee that in the near future. If that did come to be something that we would be interested in, we would apply again for a permit. It would be a different type of use, and we are well aware of that fact. ITT is looking to occupy about 21,107 square feet within within Drury Plaza. The way that their space is laid out, it's actually a separate annex of the building. It's got its separate entrance. It's not accessible from the main entrance of the complex, given the location with the building. They would take the possession of the space on July 1st, 2010, for a six-year term. Approximately 25% of the space would be used for administration, offices. It's about 5,000 square feet, the rest being used for classrooms, around 11 classrooms, a resource center, which is kind of like an electronic library, an internet cafe, and lecture and theory rooms, computer labs. A lot of ITT's courses are based in technology and the placement of technology within the business world, so this is what their focus would be, and the computer labs would help in aiding that. The hours of operation, this is kind of an important distinction for ITT's operation in 800 Drury. Their main hours of operation will be 6 p.m. till 10 p.m. They cater to an after-hours student crowd who maintain occupations and can't afford the time away from work to get their education in a normal curriculum. They do maintain classes from 8 a.m. till 5 p.m. As far as numbers of occupation, from 8 a.m. till 5 p.m., which would be our normal standard business hours for the complex, we're looking at only having about 85 people on site. That's including students, faculty, and staff. From 6 p.m. till 10 p.m., we're looking at about 165 people on staff or on site, including faculty, staff, and students. One of the main issues that I wanted to address was the parking situation with the Drury complex. You all have a matrix that I've put together of the parking situation, and I'm trying to see which where
C2
that would be the one.
Our packet.
Actually, go to page 8.
Page 8. I'm sorry. And what you'll see in this parking matrix is kind of laid out how our current parking situation is now, how our parking situation would be with ITT in place, and then hypothetically what our parking situation would be if we leased the rest of the space. What you'll notice is in the case file, there is an additional parking matrix included. What I did is after the plan commission, I went back and revised it a little bit. I made some more aggressive numbers as far as how many spots a potential tenant would occupy after hours, increasing that from a number of, I think, 2 to 25% of their parking, maintaining after hours as well. I don't believe it would be this much of a requirement, but I did want to include that. Our parking's well within the standards. IIT, per their lease, is prescribed only 4 spots per 1,000, which is our building allotment, for the hours of 8 a.m. till 5 p.m., and then an 8 per 1,000 ratio from the hours of 6 p.m. till 10 p.m. Currently, if IIT occupies the space, that would bring us to about 215 parking spots utilized between all of our tenants during the hours of 8 a.m. till 5 p.m. This puts us at a parking ratio for the complex of just about 3.05 per 1,000, again, well below our 4 per 1,000 ratio, and gives us a remaining ratio of 4.55 per 1,000. During the after-hours use, 6 p.m. till 10 p.m., which is the peak ITT use, they would bring the total occupancy of parking spaces to around 165 for them, which will bring our total parking ratio to 2.34 per 1,000 in the after hours use, giving us a remaining parking ratio of 4.95 per 1,000. Some of the special use factors, I have not made any changes to those. I was told that you may want me to read those aloud. I'm more than happy to do that. I brought those with me. And then ensuring the normal operation of other tenants in the area. Currently, there is a stoplight in place at the Drury entrance on Drury Boulevard. The increase in traffic would be no more than a normal office lease, given the time structure that ITT operates on during normal business hours. We would actually increase. It would be a negligible increase in the parking and the traffic stress on the area. And then after hours, where normal businesses have already closed up shop and people have gone home, again, there would be very little impact on the traffic. I'd like to open this time for questions, please.
Questions? Any of the board members? Mr. Young?
I've got one, and it's kind of an interesting little section of law, but I figured I'd ask it anyways.
Please do.
So on page one, so you got to kind of flip a little bit towards the special usage. So if you're looking at, you know, 13-10A-2 for special usage, I saw the little arrow down at the bottom about schools and post-baccalaureate schools must provide no more than 20% of their course offerings as a prerequisite. I'm trying to figure out here, so for them to attain a special use permit in this case, does that mean that they have to provide us with a syllabus ahead of time saying or guaranteeing that they can't have any more than 20% of the courses for admission? Is that it?
This is language that has existed in our code for some time, and we've used it. It started ordinance, so back in 1966, it's been used for Lewis University on two different occasions. It's our available language. Is it perfect? No, but
to do that, they would have to provide ahead of time a syllabus to us or something listing the courses, times and dates, and professors.
I guess I'm looking at more of it's a educational facility. It's not your typical elementary school or high school public education. It's an educational facility that provides coursework beyond what you would expect in your normal K through 12. In my opinion, the extra provisions here, I think that's added protection.
Right.
I don't think there is any conflict.
And that's not to drive conflict with the tenant. I was just looking at it. I'm saying, well, for them,
it was the best language that we had to use. We even have in our B2 district, there's language that talks about just schools. It doesn't even contain any additional caveats. And I guess in a perfect world, we could have amended our zoning text to eliminate this 20% clause. But I don't think it's really necessary.
And you'd think also in terms, and I don't know, maybe this is a separate discussion that, you know, we would have offline. Maybe we need to figure a way of getting better wording for this.
There are
part of the amendment.
I think, which was a key to our previous case, there are many instances in our code where we could have better wording throughout. So
yeah,
I definitely
especially
agree.
In an economy now where education is a primary industry.
Yes.
A lot of people are going back to school. Limiting a tenant to 20% of certain things as an educational offering is probably a detrimental thing for them.
I would expect in the coming years we will do a complete rewrite of the code and we'll address all those issues.
Okay.
Should we exempt?
Does that language mean, by the way? I've read it about 20 times. I haven't the foggiest idea.
Well, I've read it only maybe 21 times. And
so it's an unfair question. I'll withdraw the question.
Well, Champ, I guess I've got a little bit of experience in accreditation of actually scientific programs. And so the way I read this, and people from the school can chime in on this, especially, you know, if you're looking at accreditation from someone like NOCA or Midwest Association of Colleges, is that there has to be a certain percentage of courses that you have that are pre-qualifiers for a post-baccalaureate program, correct?
It's my understanding as well.
Okay. So then as part of that, there are certain minimum education classes you'd offer, like math, English, history, whatever it happened to be.
Correct.
For that program, right?
Correct.
So is the intention here of your tenant to offer those courses, or is it going to be a more specialized education? Is it?
No, it'll be more of a holistic education where all different courses are offered. If you turn,
it's L, right? And I'm not trying to distract from the application, the permit, but what I guess I'm getting at here, Champ, is that...
Yes, it is, Al.
Again, the point of it is, if a prerequisite is they have to have 20% or less of something to qualify for a BA, then they have to prove it. Or at least that's how I read the language for the 22nd time.
We could just exempt it.
Or we could exempt it.
We just exempt it.
Which is an excellent way of putting it in terms of Baker.
We'll exempt it.
Again, for the group, I don't think we need to get hung up on that aspect of it. It's a educational facility that provides much needed education for our many of our businesses. It's something that I think will fit well within our business community, and especially in light of our significant vacancies that we have in our office buildings. This really is a good find and a good.
Absolutely.
So I don't think I would get real hung up on some of the details relative to how the special use language was originally drafted.
Okay.
Any other comments, questions?
Youth day students, you kind of project 85 students and teachers.
Correct.
What can you accommodate? How big can that number get?
Per the lease or just in general for the space requirements?
In general.
I mean, per the lease, they're kind of pegged down by the parking ratio. If it did make it to that, they could probably get up to about 165,000, but they must maintain the 4 per 1,000 that is within the lease, and that would be a breach of contract if they didn't.
Okay, so the lease is going to tie them to the number of students they can have.
Correct.
And what's the duration of the lease?
6 years.
Okay.
From July 1st, 2010.
All right. Any other comments, questions? The standards, you've addressed them specifically in writing, and I think through your presentation, Mr. Fox, you've really, like number two, for example, you've addressed everything that appears to be in number two, so I don't think you need to go through them in detail. Does anybody on the board have any questions about this application of special use standards?
As a matter of formality, do
pardon?
As a matter of formality, do we exempt this definition of the 20%?
I think so.
I would not object if you do not consider that as a factor.
Well, would we do that as as one of our conditions? In other words, the three conditions that you testified to earlier that the planning board suggested,
yes,
are agreeable to both you as the owner and the ITT, I take it?
Correct.
Okay. And if someone wants to make a motion that we grant the request and that we exempt that condition from the definition of school, please do so.
So moved.
Okay, moved and seconded. We grant the request and grant the special use, and subject to the three conditions listed on page 7B imposed by the Plan Commission, and subject further to the exemption from the definition of school of the 20% language at the end of the school definition.
For the benefit of the commission, if you would like staff to actually undertake a future text amendment to modify that, we could do that.
Yeah, I think that would be appropriate, too.
I'd like to add that to the recommendation, too. Are you still okay with that, Baker?
Yep.
All right.
And it also appearing from the written materials in our file, page D, D1, and D2, that the standards for the grant of a special use have been satisfied. Gail, would you call the roll, please?
Yes. Uelen?
Yes.
Capetta?
Yes.
Emery?
Yes.
Rush?
Yes.
Young?
Yes.
Beamer?
Yes.
Davis?
Yes. So our board will approve the request for the special use, and Gail can tell you what the next step in the procedure would be.
Thank you very much for your time, everybody.
This will now go to the Village Board of Trustees on Tuesday, April 13th. 7:30 in this boardroom.
Would the chair entertain a comment from the audience?
Absolutely. I'm sorry. I didn't ask for any comments from the audience, but we will do that.
Mr. Fox, I just wondered, the thrust of your marketing effort, where do you anticipate?
Mr. Allison, could you, Richard,
we want to get you on the microphone.
We don't want to sell you
nothing
short.
Records.
You have to hear me twice, like I said once before. I was just wondering the thrust of your marketing efforts and where you anticipate the student body generating from what part of the city or area?
I have to defer on this one.
We would anticipate that our marketing drive would be similar to where it is now. And currently we draw from city, suburbs, south side, north side, a wide variety of areas. So we don't anticipate that that would change our marketing strategies.
Well, I noticed you have a facility in Burr Ridge similar to what you would propose here?
Correct.
And the students come from all over?
Correct.
Okay. My apologies for not calling on you. Anything further?
No problem.
Okay. All right. Thank you. Well, it's pretty obvious who's handling the next matter.
The only person left in the world.
The last item on the agenda is a request by York Road Development Partners, subject property 1800, 1802, and 1806 York Road, and it's a request for a variation to allow a variation from our signage ordinance for temporary marketing signage on the property. That the variance would be both in size and location. You're requesting a variance from our sign ordinance in the size of the signage and also the location of the signage where it can be placed?
That's correct.
And the number of signs.
And the quantity.
And the quantity of signs, okay. So if you'd identify yourself and I'll swear you in as a witness.
Great. Good evening. My name is Rob Oldenburg. I'm with Ergens Development Partners, and we are the, I should say I am the representative for the applicant, which is York Road Development Partners, LLC.
Okay, good. If you raise your right hand, you swear or affirm that the testimony you're about to give at this hearing will be the truth?
Yes.
I'm feeling tired.
Go ahead. You may proceed.
Just a brief reminder that the property in question is the triangular parcel located approximately at the southwest corner of York Road and I-88. It has three separate parcels, 1800, 1802, and 1806 South York Road, and we're in the process of consolidating the three parcels into a single parcel going forward. A few months ago, we appeared before the board, and we received Village Board approval in December for a number of things, which included rezoning the property from a residential district to O4. We received a special use permit to construct a medical office building on the property, and then we received concept plan approval for our project. On January 29th of this year, we closed on all three properties, and we are now the official and fee simple owner of all three parcels, which total about 2.3 acres. Our plans have not changed. We still intend to develop a three-story, approximately 74,000 square foot medical office building on the property. So now what we're doing is going out and we're marketing the project in hopes of securing enough tenants to move forward with construction of the project. We're here tonight to ask for the variances to place two additional marketing signs on the property. Currently, there's one that faces York Road. It's a V-shaped sign. Each side is 4 feet by 6 feet, and that conforms with the new sign code that was adopted a couple months ago. What we're requesting tonight is the ability to place two additional temporary marketing signs on the property, one of which would be on the west property line facing I-88, and one on the south property line facing the connector ramp between I-88 and 294. So as Mr. Killeen mentioned, there's three components to this request, one of which is the quantity, which is to allow two additional marketing signs beyond what's
currently permitted in the code. Secondly, we're requesting a variance to allow the size of the signs to increase from 24 square feet to, we're proposing two signs that are 8 feet in height and 16 feet wide. And the purpose of the size is that that is really the minimum size that they can be in order to be actually visible on the interstate, which is the entire basis of our request this evening. As you'll see, Exhibit K and L in the packet includes a couple of renderings our architect put together based on actual elevations of the area and the proposed sign and height of the signs. It projects how those signs will be visible while driving down on both of the interstate sides. And then finally, we're requesting a variance to place the signs within 5 feet of the property lines. Currently, the code allows that it cannot be within 25 feet of the property line. However, in this case, we are surrounded by tollway property on all four sides of the property, and then York Road on the east side. There's approximately 60 to 70 feet of land on our west property line and our south property line that's owned by the tollway, and that is before the grade drops off and it goes down towards the actual interstates. So we're requesting a variance to allow us to actually locate those signs within 5 feet of the property line. And I think actually that should be advantageous for everybody, in that it'll help kind of minimize the visual impact from York Road by just pushing it as far as we can to the property line. And of course, the signs will be oriented such that they will be positioned away from York Road, and the actual face of the signs will not be visible from anyone driving up and down the road.
Is there a time element to your request?
We did not identify a time element within the actual application, but we are certainly amenable to discussing a limited time period in which the sign may be put up.
And are there not folks living on the property? Aren't there residences there?
Actually, the resident that lived in the northernmost home moved out last weekend, so they're currently vacant.
Well, aren't there three homes there?
There's actually two. A third one was knocked down several years ago. We're planning on coming in and submitting a permit to actually demolish those homes and just clean up the site a little bit. We're going to be extending some utilities to the site and kind of get the site what I would call development ready. And we intend to start that work as soon as the weather changes and it's more favorable to the construction activities.
Okay. Questions or comments?
Yeah. At what point would these signs come down? They're only temporary.
Well, I mean, certainly the intent is for them to help us lease the building. We would like to leave them up as long as we can, but certainly once, we hit the time periods, specified by the board, or we lease the building, certainly there's no use for them anymore. We would take them down.
We have a
your recommendation?
Well, in our my staff report, the new sign code says that these types of signs could be good up for a one-year period, and then they could be renewed. And I think in this case, because of the high visibility, we want to be very specific about our time frame. And I also want to add the caveat that the sign needs to be maintained in its original state. Over time, even with the best intentions, these things can begin to look unsightly.
And the landscaping would apply to this.
Right, the landscaping. I did state that, correct. So
what sort of landscaping would there be to a temporary sign?
Well, maybe just put some ground cover around the base. A good example would be McDonald's. When they took over, when they let the Hawk Soccer use the fields adjacent to the off of Jory and Kensington, they put up a sign and they just put some wood chips and they put one tree up. And I think that's meeting the intent of the code.
Or Chairman Davis.
But this sign, excuse me, this sign is 8 feet above ground. So you're going to have four wooden posts sticking out.
Yes.
And I agree with the village staff recommendation for 1 year permit and renewal after 1 year.
That's correct.
Because if they don't maintain it, then we'll have them take it down.
Well, they will maintain it regardless.
Right.
Again,
those wooden posts within 3 months are going to be looked.
Right, they're going to look weathered.
Right.
Again, if we could find a way to, we want to make this sign look as good and reflective of what the end product will be. I think the developer wants to put in, you know, well over $20 million investment on this property, and I don't think we want to have a tacky sign or tacky sign.
Now, is this sign is going to be up just during the construction or till the building is leased?
Our intent is to put it up as soon as we can, and then it would stay up,
until it's built,
probably through the construction period. Assuming that, the 12-month initial period expires, and assuming we get the extensions in place, I anticipate at the end of the construction period it would come down.
This building with the underground parking, I would expect that the construction of that property will take somewhere between 12 and 18 months. So a 12-month period with a 12-month extension, I don't think that's at all unreasonable.
Right.
And what's the renewal process? Is that through the village?
They would just apply through our department for a renewal.
And they don't come back to
the board? No, they don't have to come back to the spot.
Further. Okay. Again, the standards have been addressed beginning at page E in our packet, E and E1. So we won't ask you unless you're prepared to go through these standards.
I would be happy to. I have a copy here. That's entirely up to you.
Well, we'll leave it up to you. You'd like to discuss them briefly?
I think I really hit on the high points. We really think it's going to have a minimal, minimal impact on visibility from, the York side. The Oakbrook owned side along York Road. We're really orienting these towards the tollway. We're absolutely planning on maintaining the signs to make sure they look attractive, both from the tollway side and from the York Road side.
Is it a metal sign or is it a wooden sign?
It would be a wood sign. The posts would be wood square posts as well.
Okay. To reiterate, Member Colleen, I guess my concern is, so the one that's being posted in along the highway, especially with the wind shears that come in along the highway, we definitely want to make sure it's monitored and maintained. Otherwise, like many other metal signs that are even along the highway, they get destroyed pretty quick.
Is there a requirement in the signage ordinance about maintaining the signs?
Yes.
Okay, all right.
But I want to make that, I wanted to bring it up so that it could be part of your recommendation.
All right.
It's not illuminated, is it? We're not going to put some temporary lighting on it?
They could be illuminated. Again, it would have to be illuminated in accordance with the new sign code, which talks about the source of the light has to be shielded, et cetera. So I'm okay if they come back at a later date and light them, that's fine with me.
And then,
because the issue at hand is, they want two additional signs. They want larger signs. They want them located. They're really not seeking any relief for lighting or anything like that.
Okay.
And just a clarification: we're only approving the concept of this. You're actually approving the structural details and granting the permit for that, so that it is weatherproof and braced accordingly.
But also, you will reference the plans as they've been depicted, so that if they come back with pink blinking lights, that's not what you saw, and that's not what we will approve.
The neighborhood.
Yes, it'll ruin the neighborhood.
But I'm just anticipating that there's going to need to be some bracing.
That's correct.
And so
that's
forth
correct.
To
but
that,
you'd,
which
you'd say we'll approve the plans as depicted in the case file.
Mm-hmm.
So it gives a representation.
Right. And we do plan on adding some additional bracing to help with. We realize that it being up above the tollway, it is going to be subject to some wind pushing and bending in, so we will put the necessary support structure in place so that it ensures it's going to stay up and look nice.
Well, I drive by the subject property every morning on my way to work, so I'll be sure and let Mr. Colleen know if anything untoward is happening.
Mr. Chairman, keep your eyes on the road.
I go by that
texting
little turn off there.
And no text.
Okay, any other questions or comments? All right, the standards having been addressed, and is there a motion to approve the request for the three variations to our signage ordinance that have been requested, subject to the conditions that the signs be constructed according to the plans as depicted in our packets, and subject to the establishment of a time frame of 12 months as the initial time frame, with the possibility of an additional renewal for 12 months, subject also to the requirement that the signs have landscaping around the base of the signs, and I believe those are the only conditions. Anything else?
And also that they be maintained.
Yes, I'm sorry. And that the signs be maintained as required by the signage ordinance. Subject to those conditions.
And the caveat that the applicant shall meet all village ordinance requirements.
You always raise that every time. I mean, isn't that natural that we have a caveat? Where is it?
Item four.
Item four here. That notwithstanding the attached exhibits, the applicant shall meet all village ordinance requirements, which I'm sure you're satisfied to do, except as may be varied or waived. Subject to all of those conditions, is there a motion to grant the request?
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Gail, will you call the roll, please?
Bulin?
Yes.
Capetta?
Yes.
Emery?
Yes.
Rush?
Yes.
Young?
Yes.
Zimmer?
Yes.
Davis?
Yes.
So your request has been granted. We will make a recommendation to the village board, and then your variation request will go to the village board on
April 13th.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Forgot to ask if there are any comments from the
peanut gallery.
Is there anybody to provide comments? No?
All right. We didn't do that 10 till 9.
No, had we left the item for 5A on the agenda, we would be here. We would be here.
Well, that'll be
significantly later.
That'll be interesting to hear. Do we have other items on our next month's agenda?
For April, yes, we will probably have the Oak Brook Club. It's going to be at the Plan Commission level.
Club and Phyllis.
The Oak Brook Club, that's really a housekeeping item.
Right.
Previously, we all discussed that.
Right.
We adopted the R5 zoning district, that it really should apply to the Oak Brook Club. We're going through that, just the administrative step to make that
work.
And that's something that'll come back before us. Okay. And then if there will be a lot of comment, will the Fullersburg Historic Foundation matter? Will that be the first item on the agenda? Okay. All right. Any other business? If not, yes.
On this language change on the zoning code for the school, you guys will come back to us and tell us what the new language is, or you don't have to do that?
It'll come back to you.
Okay.
Okay. Anything further?
If you want me to take a look, I can.
Come up with something profound.
All right. If there's nothing further, is there a motion to adjourn?
So
moved and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? All right. We'll see you all on the.
My wife said it'd be 10 o'clock. Yeah, okay.